Good afternoon, everyone. This is Lecture 1 for Chapter 3, Matters and Minerals. Let's start with defining what a mineral is. A mineral is naturally occurring, inorganic, solid, with an orderly crystalline structure, which means that the atoms are regular and repeating, and has a definite chemical composition, such as quartz is silicon dioxide, one silicon atom to two oxygen atoms. A rock, on the other hand, is a consolidation of one or more minerals or mineral-like matter. Let's discuss atoms. Atoms are the smallest particles of matter that cannot be chemically split. In the center of all atoms is the nucleus, which consists of positively charged protons and neutral neutrons. Surrounding the nucleus are electrons. They have a charge of -1. The mass of the atom sits in the nucleus. Electrons are essentially non-massive. They are small in mass compared to protons and neutrons. The outermost shell of electrons are referred to as valence electrons, and their significance is that these are the electrons that form chemical bonds. Here is a picture of an atom with the nucleus consisting of the protons and neutrons. That's where the mass of the atom sits, and the electrons orbiting. In reality, the electrons exist in what is referred to as an electron cloud, but it is much easier to visualize an atom with a drawing like this. If we look at the periodic table of elements, there is an atomic number associated with each element. The atomic number is the number at the top of each box, and the atomic numbers tells us how many protons are present in the element. And since all of these elements are neutral in charge, the atomic number also tells us the number of electrons. So there are approximately 90 naturally occurring elements, and there are others that have been made in the laboratory or synthesized. Most elements join with other elements to form compounds. Now, what's nice about this periodic table is each element has its atomic number, which all periodic tables do, the symbol, the atomic weight of the element, and then the name. In addition, we have an area that tells us where or which elements tend to lose electrons, which ones tend to gain electrons, which ones tend to share one or more pairs of electrons. And this stair step is the break between all metals versus the nonmetals. And hydrogen is also considered a nonmetal. Chemical bonds form between atoms by transferring or sharing electrons. There are a couple other different types of bonds that we'll talk about as well. According to the octet rule, the most stable electron configuration for an atom is having 8 electrons in the outermost or valence shell. If the atom doesn't have 8 electrons in the outermost shell, its tendency will want to combine with another atom so that it reaches this more stable state. This is the electron dot diagram for some elements, and actually these are mislabeled. Today we have a standardized system where this is actually group 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 1, 2, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, and 18. The Roman numerals are no longer used. And what this diagram is showing is the number of electrons in the outermost shell. Okay, so lithium, Li here, has one electron in its outer shell, as all group 1s do. All group 2s have two electrons in their outer shell. All group 13s have three in their outer shell. 14s have four in their outer shell, and so on. The first type of bond is the ionic bond. In the ionic bond, there is a transfer of electrons between atoms, which forms ions. An ion is simply a charged atom, either positive or negative. Let's take a look at an example of a mineral that has an ionic bond. And halite, which is rock salt, is what we will be looking at. If you look at the periodic table, you will see that sodium has 11 electrons and 11 protons. Chlorine has 17 electrons and 17 protons. Now, with sodium, there is only one electron in the outer shell, so it's the tendency of that electron is to be transferred, and that's exactly what happens. So when sodium loses an electron, it is now an ion. It has one less electron than protons, and so it becomes a plus one ion. Likewise, with chlorine, it will happily pick up that electron that sodium gave up, and now it has a full outer shell of electrons. It has eight now instead of seven, and so that makes it with one extra electron than proton and gives the ion a negative charge. So what creates the bond is the positive and negative charges on these ions. That is the ionic bond. Atoms that share one or more valence electrons have a covalent bond. Let's take an example of ordinary hydrogen, which has one electron, and we're going to combine it with another hydrogen to form the hydrogen molecule H2. So rather than transferring electrons, as in the halite example, here the hydrogen atoms share their electrons. And you can think of sharing the electrons as that these electron pairs spend more time between the two atoms than on their outsides. The last bond type we'll be talking about is the metallic bond. When we think of metals, most of us think of copper, iron, lead, gold, silver. Those are actually called transition metals, but those are the metals that actually have a metallic bond. In the transition metals, the electrons are so loosely attached that they flow, and they create, as shown with these blue lines in this diagram, a sea of electrons, an ocean of electrons. So all of this gray area is negatively charged. Where did those sea of electrons come from? The metal atom here in red. So if these atoms are giving up electrons, they become positively charged. So it is the positively charged red atom shown here and the negative sea of electrons that create the metallic bond. Finally, a mention here for hybrid bonds. Most substances have more than one bond type. They're not purely covalently bonded or purely ionically bonded. They can be 30% covalent, 70% ionic, for example. So that's what they refer to as a hybrid bond.